Let's get going.
Get this party started?
Yeah. Brian's on his way. Okay. Welcome to the Town of Hopkinton Planning Board meeting for Monday, January 23rd, 2017. Thank you, HCAM, for taping the meeting. We've got a couple of people that are going to be absent. Our vice chairman will be coming very shortly. I think he's on his way. I'd like to congratulate the Patriots for an outstanding game, and at least we'll have something very memorable to look at.
I second that.
In two more weeks. The agenda's relatively light tonight. We have a public hearing on a proposed amendment to the zoning bylaws, which would place a temporary moratorium on recreational marijuana establishments. We have at 8:30 a continued public hearing on the minor site plan review. And then we've got some updates on zoning, getting ready for town meeting. We have some annual report work to do. We got a budget that we got to look at, and the implementation primarily of our master plan items. So, given that, we'll open the public hearing for a proposed amendment to the zoning bylaw, the temporary moratorium on marijuana establishment. This has been duly advertised. If we have to advertise every public hearing prior to any article that's going on the warrant. So basically, we're here to hear what people think about it. There's not an awful lot of folks in the audience, but Denise is our Director of Youth and Family Services. Do you want to come up here and talk a little bit about it? We had, as I think most of the planning board members know, there was a meeting with the selectmen and Board of Health, Fire Chief, Police Chief. I was there. Denise was there. And that group, Town Council was there, kind of said the best thing to go is to go with a moratorium because we honestly don't know what the law is really going to end up after the legislature makes a bunch of changes. And then there was also a lot of testimony that maybe we'll hear again from some folks that some of the concerns that and some of the things we're going to have to do to mitigate those concerns, I think, they're coming. But Denise,
wanted to. So initially, a lot of the deadlines were coming up in September that the regulations had to be enacted. But I know I had put this in a memo to the board, but for the public watching on TV, I just wanted to let everyone know that the state has extended all those deadlines by 6 months. So now everything's been pushed out till 2018, so we have more time now to craft regulations and do some more studying and planning. So the state wasn't ready with their Cannabis Control Commission and doing their regulations, so they pushed everything out by 6 months. So,
yeah, I just wanted to piggyback on that, Mr. Chairman. So essentially, the state right now has not defined
correct
any of that legislation.
So I don't even think they've appointed anyone to the commission yet.
That's correct.
And which is, I think, appointed by the treasurer, or is it?
I'm not sure.
I think it's the treasurer, if I remember correctly. But whichever state official has to do it has not done it yet. And I know the legislature is, well, this was an advocacy group that put the ballot question for it, and they wrote it the way they wanted it to go, and the legislatures, I know, are looking at why is it only taxed at like 3% versus a lot of
Colorado,
which was a lot more, et cetera. And then there was a lot of other things that were written in a weird sense of way that nobody understands what they really mean by some of the stuff, but because it's not written in municipal or Massachusetts municipal law type or stuff. So, Denise, do you want to kind of lead us off tonight?
Sure. So, speaking from the youth and family side of things, my encouragement to the board is to really proceed very cautiously and thoughtfully with whatever you decide to do. The data out of Colorado as sort of the template for what we might be seeing has not been great as it pertains to youth, so legalization has
Denise,
occurred.
Can you come up a little closer or come up to the table here?
I can't hear you on TV.
Oh, usually people can hear me just fine wherever I am, including my kids.
Yeah. Well, that's important.
Yeah. So as I was saying, speaking from the youth and family services side of things, obviously, legalization has occurred. Legalization is intended for folks over 21 years of age. But what we know in Colorado is that has trickled down to youth, and that, you know, our use of youth using marijuana in Colorado has increased exponentially, increased emergency room visits, increased folks driving under the influence. So we're likely to see some really sobering things occurring in Massachusetts if we follow suit with what has happened in Colorado, which I would expect that we would. So from the youth and family services side of things, I expect that my job here in Hopkinton is going to get quite a bit harder, no matter what happens in terms of Hopkinton, because whether we have pot available here in Hopkinton, it's going to be available in other places. We're going to be facing a lot of probably some scary things happening with our youth. So the folks that I deal with in town who are addicted to heroin, I think pretty much all of them will say that their use started with marijuana and alcohol, so it certainly is a gateway drug. Not to say that everybody that uses marijuana is going to end up using heroin or anything else more serious than that, but that is the trend that we see with folks who go on to things that are more serious. So I don't want to go sort of on and on, because I know there'll be further conversations about this later, but I just would encourage the board to be really careful and thoughtful about whatever decisions you make, just knowing from my perspective and the experience that I have that tells me that we're likely to see some scary things happening with regard to marijuana use going forward.
Thank you.
Does anyone have any questions of Denise? If you can stick around just a little bit longer.
Yeah, sure.
Because we don't have a lot of folks coming up here. Mm-hmm. I'd like to echo a little bit of what she said about the concerns. I don't know whether you saw Hop News, but one of my neighbor's kids just this week died at age 34. Mm-hmm. And he had problems from early high school days. It was a nice tribute to the Little League in that, quite frankly, the only thing the kid enjoyed was playing Little League. And when he got in trouble with smoking marijuana in high school, they threw him off the high school baseball team, which was the only thing the kid liked. And he's had not, and his parents, I really feel sorry for the parents. And, you know, there's another funeral that we went to, former chairman of the ZBA, just this year. So, I mean, this is two people that, you know, I'll be going to the wake early, you know, because personally lives a couple houses from me. It's just a shame. It really is. And I just hope that we can do other things, not from the zoning standpoint, but, you know, we're going to have to do a lot more planning once. And that's not to say there isn't any drugs in Hopkinton today. I mean, it's probably as bad as any other town around, I just hope it's not going to get worse.
And Chief? Legalization has made the conversation with youth much harder to sort of say, you know, this marijuana can be hard for you. It can lead to difficult things happening in your life. It's not just harmless for everybody. And so I certainly the Hopkinton students that I work with, that conversation has got a lot harder in terms of educating them about the ways in which marijuana can negatively impact their lives. Legalization sort of normalizes it for them, and it becomes, you know, really hard to convince them otherwise. But, you know, I have clients for whom it's not only a gateway drug, but who just are just using marijuana, and that in and of itself has created trouble for them, getting through school, getting good grades, meeting the goals of their peers. So just encouragement on your part to really be thoughtful about what you do.
It's almost like taking away one of your tools to help.
Definitely, yeah.
Chief?
So just my experience working with Denise and what I've seen in town in my short time as fire chief, I echo her concerns. I worry about our community. I worry about the unknown of the social impact of the legalization. It's kind of new to me in the studies. I think my one little editorial as a youth in Hockington growing up, alcohol was kind of the socially acceptable drug in our community, and I worry about this mirroring a path like that for what I went through as a kid in Hockington, so I hope it doesn't, but I do, as a person that grew up in Hockington, worry about that a lot, and with the work that Denise does, I'm just, I feel for her, for the amount of work it could bring for her, trying to help everybody in Hockington, so something to think about. I think just pulling back from a public safety point of view, again, the unknown social impact. Right now, what we do for public safety and serving the community is, I think everybody knows police and fire right now. We do well serving the community, but we're at our capacity. I don't think that's an unknown piece. We do the best we can for the community with the amount of money that we spend. And as we try to deal with the normal growth in the community, this unknown social impact worries us. So just as I'm not sure what I'm supposed to do to advise you for preparing for any of the increases, I've just recently took some of the stuff that came from the police chief in our meeting. He had a lot of data that they studied a lot through the federal drug task force that write a lot of the reports that work in Colorado. The information is there's a series of annual reports that I started to pour through. It's the Rocky Mountain High Intensity Drug Trafficking Area that writes these reports. It's the legalization of marijuana in Colorado impact. There's four volumes that I saw so far. Each volume that has come through since, say, 2011 is not only showing an increase, but it seems like there is increase to the increase on each report. So Denise touched on a couple of the areas. I'll just mention it to you. They're in every area that they've looked at so far. Impact in driving, impact to use, adult usage, emergency room visits, exposure to marijuana-related incidents that they've dealt with, treatments, what they find when they're doing traffic stops in Colorado through the mail, one of the stats is the number of stores that they had that caught me versus Starbucks and McDonald's was like almost double for marijuana stores. Those are things like I'm not sure what's going to happen in Massachusetts yet. I hope that you, with our work, we can find time to get a little more data so we can understand the impact to Hockington so that we can prepare for it. It's coming is kind of what I am getting out of this. I'd almost challenge us all, though, that I did see in Colorado that it was a very high percentage of areas have gone and made it so that it's not legal. I still don't know where Hockington will land. I'm so concerned about it. I still hope that's kind of an option, but I don't know what it is for today when we're just studying what our ability is to just potentially push it out to study it. I think that's the first smart move that our whole group saw, so I'm okay with that. I'm not trying to pick a fight to say, let's not do that, but I think we, as board members, as community members, kind of got to look at this social impact and get a better grasp to it before we make decisions that really lock in final usages to the community. So the piece I want to say to you when I say something like we're at capacity, you need to realize that our service is going to end up having usage in this area, and that's what impacts the other people in their everyday lives. And I just want to make sure I'm delivering that message. It does go up. We deal a lot lately with a rise in mental health issues, a rise in drug use. We're here to help those people, and the others need to realize as that volume goes up, it affects everybody. Mm-hmm. So I think that's my message. If you have any questions, I can try to go on. I still have a lot more research to do to prepare for, you know, a really professional view back to you. But my first pieces that I'm seeing in these reports makes me nervous as a service delivery person for our community.
Thanks.
I just real quick, because I mean, there's a lot of things to look at when we talk about this, and I'm sorry for showing up late and I missed part of your presentation, and I apologize. But growing up, you know, in the town that I grew up in, we were a dry town. So I'm talking obviously alcohol.
Yeah.
That didn't mean that high school kids
and
people didn't bring alcohol into the town. Mm-hmm. And so even if we, I think we do need to really look at what we want to do in regards to, you know, the sale of recreational marijuana.
Mm-hmm.
But even if we were to ban it,
sure,
doesn't mean it's not going to stop it from coming in.
Sure.
And that's just a reality.
Mm-hmm.
that we all need to deal with.
Yep. I think that it was interesting in the report, and I think there's some more study to do. The places, the example is that really stood out is Denver. You know, Denver is kind of the center of legalization. And their percentages are much higher than areas, even other cities that didn't legalize. So whether it's a true comparison or not, I'm not sure. That's where I think we got to put our work into. And again, it's coming, so there's a level of preparation we're going to have to do regardless. I think it's just what is the level of preparation. And then the community, we might present something to them that says, you know, if instead of adding another ambulance and adding more staff to Denise's group, maybe there is a data point that helps us decide, you know, that we can curb it in some other manner. I don't know the answer to that yet. I think that's why the ask is there a way we can push this out some and make a more educated decision on it?
And having pot shops in town does send a message to youth, especially, I think. A normalization message of it's okay here to buy here to use it here. You know, they're going to be able to get it in other places certainly, but do we want to send the message that we want to have pot shops here? Because I think that sends a stronger message of well, it's here.
I understand that. What's the legal age, you know, under the
21.
Law? 21, no different from alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
We have alcohol stores in
mm-hmm.
town.
Mm-hmm.
Does it send a message to our youth that it's okay for them to drink?
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of what
I'm just asking a question, that's all.
What we know about Colorado is it was 21 there too, and the rise in underage use skyrocketed.
It terrifies me,
yeah.
Believe me. I'm just asking that question just to get that out there.
Yeah.
I mean, are we telling our youth that it's okay for them to drink?
My anecdotal story is, as a child growing up in Hopkinton, that's what the end game was.
Yeah.
You know,
if it's
we were exposed to alcohol earlier. It became almost socially acceptable in our families, and it caused a lot of problems for myself and others that grew up in this town. So I look at that and I go, I hope that doesn't correlate to what's coming forward with marijuana. And if it does, if there is some data or science, it's worth our community looking at it.
Yeah.
You know, my experience is, you know, alcohol's here to stay. Maybe this is coming and maybe it's here to stay. I don't know the final answer to that. I don't even make pretend to know that, but it's worth us having some really healthy dialogue right now.
Absolutely.
While we have a chance and kind of see if there's a way we can land a solution that helps our community a little more than others. I think the difference that might be there is when I looked at the data in Colorado, you know, we're talking about 60 some odd percent of areas that didn't allow the sale of it. So, you know, alcohol, there is a dry town or two, but it was when I grew up, it was just socially acceptable, and it was acceptable even to younger ages. You know, it was nothing for a 16-year-old to have a beer with his dad or something like that. I don't know if we want that type of normalization with this. I think that's where you got to have a lot of dialogue. I wish this was a larger hearing to start the dialogue. That's kind of what we said. You know, from the public safety side or the service side, we'll give you one piece. The community's got to kind of get into more to how's it going to impact us as a community.
Through the chair.
Yeah, go.
Two items, and I agree with what you've said. I have a background. I was chair of the PFAC, the Milford Regional, and during that time had started a major push on behavioral health.
Yep.
And the impact
of some of the decriminalization that's taken place already in Massachusetts helped to spur a significant increase in drug use in the high school population, because it's very hard, even though it was kind of a step down, so to speak, to that same thing, the argument that, well, it's no longer what it was, it's now acceptable. So that's one thing. The second thing is, if you look at Colorado and in Washington, preliminary studies are the impact, taking a totally different tact, on property values, that it diminishes in those communities where the sale is not restricted or eliminated, that their property values are less than the communities that both on the residential and the commercial. And you think about it, if you're moving your family of kids in and you have a choice between Southborough and Hopkinton has two marijuana retail stores in the middle of town, and Southborough has dozen, that may lean you in a direction. So from a pocketbook point of view, you know, both for looking at revitalization of downtown and also the impact on property values, it has a it definitely has an impact. And kind of go back to when we were talking about medical marijuana, and I think Claire and I kind of led the charge on limiting locations. I said, I don't want to have to have my neighbors give direction to their friends coming to their house that you can make a right at the pot shop and go down the street and that's my house, because again, it impacts the property values. So take everything else away from it. You know, looking at, we're trying to revitalize downtown, if you're now going to allow it in parts of downtown, what are the chances of, if the yogurt store wasn't there and a pot shop was at the pizza place, what do you think the chances of the yogurt store going in next door? Not going to happen. So it definitely has an impact on both commercial development and property value. And I think even if you make the argument on everything else on a libertarian point of view, on that point of view, it deserves careful attention and careful review.
David? So one comment I have is that I wish our legislation, the state legislation, would look at doing something like Florida did. I believe Florida has it, where you actually need a 60% vote in order to change a law, because I think it was only, somebody correct me if I'm wrong, but wasn't it like 53-47
here
or something like that here? It wasn't an overwhelming
tight vote.
Secondly, I think, to Brian's point about the analogy between drinking and smoking marijuana, we have one vice, alcohol. Mm-hmm. It's kind of socially accepted because it is an aid for socializing with people, right? I mean, it's kind of accepted, bars and stuff like that.
Yep.
So I don't think it's a fair comparison to that, because we don't need more vices for socialization. Should we legalize heroin so people can socialize together? You know what I mean? So I don't think it's a fair. A lot of people make it, but I don't think it has any value in our society as far as the comparison, because one vice is enough, in my opinion.
Great.
Mr. Chairman, I think, you know, to John's point, when you start to aggregate these different factors and the fact that the state has not defined exactly how they're going to proceed, I think the prudent course of action would be to look at a moratorium for a period of time. Mm-hmm. I'd be curious in terms of the action steps that you are looking to develop as well, mm-hmm. in conjunction, so a moratorium, but yet when it's going to happen, and Chief, to
sure.
your point, it's going to happen at some point,
sure.
that we are ahead of the ball, and not necessarily being reactive to
sure.
to whatever. So,
mm-hmm. Matt?
To the chair. Are any town employees subject to mandatory drug tests today?
I know the CDL requirements that you run under for, like, say, the highway department has a piece that has drug testing. Fire is not required to have CDL. They have some contract language for future ability to potentially enter into drug testing. Police has some requirements just due to firearms and federal law. But again, even when you start to mix in federal law here, the courts are untested how much federal law is going to impact any of this.
Yeah,
so
if you get a license to carry, you have to have, you cannot.
But we also have a drug-free workplace in the town of Hockington, and at any time if you're found to be smoking any illegal substance, they can terminate you.
Okay.
So there's some issues that it'll kind of expand as we go. As you change in society, we'll have to work on our policies and make sure we're covering what's happening.
Quick question. Yeah. Chief, we've talked about Colorado, which obviously it's fairly new.
Yep.
And I think anybody who remembers, not that I was there, but when Prohibition was over, there was a rush to the bars. Has anyone thought about looking at any of the nations where it's been legal for decades, just to get a longer sample size versus what's happening just recently? I'm just curious over the course. I know, and again, I didn't grow up there either, but in Italy, you can drink wine pretty much at any age you want, and perhaps alcoholism is rampant there. I'd never heard of that, and I'm just curious as to the sample size that you have in Colorado versus maybe the Netherlands or someplace, Norway or wherever.
That's a really valid point, and that's why I think the idea is let's put some extension on here where we can find some more.
Yeah.
Find a data point that we all feel comfortable with. I don't want to be the person that just randomly picks something. Colorado stood out just because I'm making some early assumptions that they've done some of those ideas and looks as they're bringing their research together.
Right.
I definitely feel like we're trying to catch this thing.
That's
kind of run ahead on us a little bit. So it passed, and I went, whoa, when it passed. And I kind of got, I feel like I'm caught a little by surprise having all the information. So now we've got to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
I think a couple of just little hidden points that I'm worried about that kind of go from traditional and success stories maybe somewhere else. Marijuana might have been considered fairly benign through the history of it, but... I just look at kind of what's happening with that transition from heroin to a fentanyl base, and I'm sitting here now doing some reading, and the big thing is there's an impact to the fires in your community because they're creating these synthetics or boiling the marijuana down to get the more potent subsets now, and this hashish oil, I had a bunch of articles, so I'm not sure if they're just finding it more or if it's true data, but in Colorado they went from like 12 explosions in a year, and then 2 years later they were up to 24 explosions within 6 months, and they're just starting to, is it evolving into what's happened with heroin?
Mm-hmm.
And that's the scary is, the stories that go around like with these edibles, and then they get some type of synthetic component to them, and... people are having reactions that are far greater than they're used to just under these normal things you might find in some of these other comparisons if it was like you're talking about.
Right.
Just one of the stories I dealt with, I talked about a couple of the firemen that had helped a police officer up in New Hampshire in a piece, and it ended up that this person that they were helping, the police officer in distress, was under one of these synthetics. They had some of these in the city of Boston with these fights where you read the articles, they can't subdue them. They're hitting them with tasers multiple times and they can't subdue them. It's like this fight or flight that is in them nobody's dealt with before.
Right.
And I just sit there and I go, there's no like true data point yet, but I am worried, especially from what I've seen with heroin, that where is this going? Because we're seeing so many deaths with heroin because they're having this impact that even the experienced people aren't used to, and they're dying. And so I don't know. And I'm not trying to sensationalize it, but there's a lot of moving parts here, and they've made some really quick decisions in my mind that we're not prepared for. So hopefully we get together and start looking at all of these impacts.
That's true.
Yeah.
First, I agree. We need to put a moratorium out there and do our due diligence and really look at everything. I have to say that first. other studies from any of the other states where it's been legal for a couple of years? I mean, we keep talking Colorado, and that's the one we hear about the most in the news, too. Mm-hmm. But there are other states, and are there similar studies, or are there different studies?
I think there's only one other state, Washington.
Washington, is that the only one?
Substantial time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Those are the two that I heard referred to, was Washington and Colorado. And I haven't gone deep. Those are the ones that had the most data available, the stories. You know, these reports are about 4 or 5 years in concession, and that you're able to kind of see a pattern of the data come in. So it kind of gives you at least a little bit of perspective. Some of it might just be recognizing what the change is. I'm not sure yet, so...
And in neither of those places has the data on youth been good.
Right.
And I think we were overwhelmed with this election. There are a number of states approved it, and especially a lot of focus on California because of the serious numbers of people there that it's like almost that kind of like pushed it over the edge.
Okay. So I think we haven't heard anything that says moratorium isn't a good idea. I'm going to ask members, are we ready to close the hearing and then vote to make a recommendation tonight?
I'm ready.
I am ready.
Okay. Why don't we take a motion first to close the public hearing? Entertained.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Okay. Any discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay. Now, I think I'd entertain a motion that we recommend to, or we place the moratorium that our town council wrote for us on the warrant, and that we recommend it to the town meeting vote.
Moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion.
Fran.
Yeah.
So just to clarify, Mr. Chairman, this moratorium would extend through what date? Is it
August
30th, 31st, 2018?
Correct.
Okay.
And basically the wording that we're going on is this sheet here.
Yeah.
Can I just, so this wording that you had does not reflect the six-month change that the state created to the September 15th, 2017 date, so that would just get changed to reflect the state. Where in the first paragraph, when it says that the Cannabis Control Commission is required to issue regulations regarding implementation.
Okay, we'll update that first paragraph by the proper what the current thing is. I still think that the August date will allow us to present something. Not at this next annual town meeting, but
the one thereafter.
Thereafter, and then it'll get approved by end of June by the Attorney General, and then we could implement it by the end of August from a zoning standpoint, however we choose to do it. I mean, and we've got a lot of work to do to figure that all out, but this will give us a lot more time to do it.
Do you want to add the planning board as sponsor to the article?
Well, we're going to sponsor it, yes. Okay. Yeah, we're submitting. The vote to submit it to the motion was to submit it and recommend it.
Okay.
So, yeah, we're sponsors as a zoning. And hopefully we'll have some support by a lot. And I sense that from the meeting we had with the selectmen that we're going to get a lot of support from other town boards to that. And obviously, the public is not terribly over-concerned today, or otherwise they would pack the room, which has not happened. Okay, are we ready for a vote now? Okay, call for the vote. All those in favor of the motion to submit it to the town meeting and recommend it, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. So this will be on the annual town meeting warrant. Which we're starting to prepare. And thank you both for coming in, Chief.
Thank
if you want to stick
thank
around,
you.
You're more than welcome.
Appreciate
but,
it. Appreciate but, you.
Thank you. Thank you, Denise, for
thank you.
Coming
thanks,
in.
Appreciate
Denise.
It.
And for those people that don't know, we have a Youth and Family Services. Denise is a really nice person, and if you need her help, get it.
He wasn't smiling much, but thank you.
Okay. We got 20 minutes not to kill because we can get lots of things done so we get out of here at a very good time tonight. Let's take up the update from the Zoning Advisory Committee. I believe there is a list in your package that defines what they're working on. And they voted to recommend the first one that they voted to recommend. Now, let's go through these really quickly, and there's more questions if you have them. We will be holding a similar public hearing on the 27th of February. That is our current plan. And then we have usually like the 1st of March, which to vote to send these off to town meeting. So it's kind of that plan is to hold the hearing and vote to send it off. Most of these are relatively easy things compared to some of the big issues we've had. But the first one is the definition of restaurant, and that comes out of the Dunkin' Donuts deal. They voted to recommend that to us, and they defined a restaurant and put together some parking requirements for that. And we can start to see what they're talking about in some of this area. The next one that they've recommended is the definition of gross floor space and site plan review. I believe this, in essence, puts garages into the square footage to make a minor. We had a couple commercial guys that added garages, and there was a loophole, and they got through it, and it might have been not the best thing. So anyway, but that's not a really big one, I don't think. I mean, the flexible community development bylaw, let's see, what was that one to do with? That had to do with, how many bedrooms was in there, and we require funds to build a 3-bedroom unit, I believe, and that's clarifying a little loophole. So it's adding a sentence to
that. Right, because we had a developer who was building 2-bedroom units, and they were confused as to if they had to do payments for 2 bedrooms or 3 bedrooms, and so this just clarifies that no matter how many bedrooms you're building, you have to do payments for 3-bedroom units.
And then we have the timing of the conveyance of the open space for the open space landscape preservation bylaw. It's kind of a technical thing. I don't expect there'll be too much on town meeting floor for that. I would hope not. It's kind of interesting. They voted to take no action on prohibiting roosters in the residential areas.
I had a question. Why no action?
They did not want to.
Sex discrimination. I was not at that meeting. I don't. Yeah. they don't want to regulate roosters.
Roosters are people too.
I've got a rooster that's two houses away from me, and it's lovely to hear. Yeah, it goes with the that rural character of the town.
It's part of your alarm clock.
Yeah. No, it's all day long. But and then the last one they've gone through is a hotel parking requirement, which I guess we did not have one written in the bylaw per se, and we it would be nice to if we attracted a hotel. So that's kind of where there are. The last two meetings, I think they've missed quorums.
That's correct.
So that's not good. Hopefully their chairman will, or maybe somebody in the staff will help them.
Yeah, they have another meeting scheduled for Thursday evening, and they're hoping for a quorum. They have a couple additional that they're still looking at, possibly some change to the signage bylaw, and they're still discussing Airbnb information, but Elaine doesn't think that that's going to go anywhere, for at least for this town meeting. So it doesn't seem to be a big issue in this community, so...
Mm-hmm.
So that they need to be regulated.
And hopefully they're thinking about the front setback requirement for the agricultural one. That's the one where we require 20-foot wide driveway because to meet our zoning, that doesn't make any sense. But
or is that the driveway bylaw?
No.
It's one right before it.
Well, I guess it's in both. They were figuring out a way to maybe...
Yeah, you're right. Those two look like they're related.
Yeah. Okay, so that's the update. John?
Yeah. I do have a concern on the parking. Because I don't think under this, look at our Starbucks experience, and I don't think this increases the parking that would be necessary for Starbucks, but for the fact that the outside seating would be included. So I think the parking really has to be looked into, because if we haven't learned our lesson already, we should have.
This is the parking on the restaurant.
Correct. Okay. Because Starbucks has seats, there would be one space for every three seats, plus one space for every two employees.
So it's on the list or not on the list?
Well, it's what they're proposing does not appear, and maybe I need to explain, Okay. Get it explained, does not appear to increase the need for seating for that type of establishment, which I think needs to be done.
So some of the problem with the Starbucks is they're adding seating when they seat outdoors, and that would need to be included for all the parking.
Right, but if you had Starbucks without the outside seating, we still have a problem.
Right.
So exactly. Your concern is more the definition of...
Correct. Of...
Of what Starbucks is.
Right, which versus. Also includes Dunkin'.
Right.
Donuts, and because it's a... I think it throws it all into one basket, but there is a big difference between a heavy takeout place with seating
right. And
a sit-down restaurant that has casual takeout.
Right, and I think at one point they were going to consider multiple definitions to sort of address that issue, but ultimately they decided to lump it all together under a bigger umbrella similar to the sit-down restaurant type thing. So I think this parking requirement would be more parking than a Dunkin' Donuts would need, but adequate for a sit-down restaurant. Does that make sense?
Well, I'm not sure if Dunkin' has... I'd like to see the Dunkin' that we did, here's the parking, and then based on this, what the parking is. And then Starbucks do the same and see what the parking is, even though Starbucks is shared.
I was going to say, it's hard to do with this Starbucks because
right.
It's a shared use.
But to depend on the fact that they have outdoor seating...
Well, I don't think that's the sole change, though. I'll make that note and
well,
see.
Why don't you start giving us maybe a photocopy of the pages where the parking numbers kind of come from?
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a civil engineer traffic manual or something that's kind of says for this use.
Well, we have that in our existing zoning, but you're looking for like what the recommended
industry standards as
okay.
to, you know, are we getting, you know, are we at industry standards, and you know, we can take Zach's recommendation, then this board can also modify it too, and
yeah.
And you know, we got to make sure that we kind of cover ourselves. I really don't want to go to a special permit on something like that, because you're going to kill that industry per se. But and I think they were thought politically it might be better to put every restaurant under the same guise. But does that? I think to John's point, maybe there's restaurants and then there's other kinds of restaurants. I mean,
yeah, because you have restaurants on Main Street that have no parking, street parking.
Right.
How do they get a permit then?
Yeah, well, the worst part that we've got in Main Street, you know, our parking requirements is you take it all and then you divide it by two, and that happens to be, in my opinion, why the new building is still empty, is because you will not put a restaurant in a building that you can't have parking, because people will just keep going if they see it's full.
That's right, Johnny.
And so I think that was not a great business decision per se, when, you know, it doesn't, you know, it hasn't been able to fill it up, and it's true to the parking, and I haven't talked to him about it, so I don't know that for a fact, but I kind of wished it was empty.
Yeah.
wished it was not empty, you know. It was. Anyway, okay, so this is where we are on zoning. Okay, let's go through the annual report. The annual report is fairly cut and dry. It's really a list of what this board kind of did in the last year or so. And I don't think that we missed anything, because I think it's pretty detailed as to what we ended up doing. So entertain a motion to submit the annual report for 2016.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, further discussion. Did anyone have any changes to it?
I have one question, maybe, okay. Mr. Chairman.
Sure, go ahead.
Maybe this happened in 2015. I'm losing it here. Did we do the tree trimming? Was that?
That was in 2015.
Was that late 15?
Yeah, that was. I took that out of the, when I cut and paste on for 2016, it was something I removed.
Okay, I just remember, maybe we just, yeah, it was done, we walked it in the spring. And that's what it was, Jim. Put the ribbons on the trees.
Oh, so there is some trees?
No, that was the previous year.
Late 2000.
Okay. Okay. Any other changes, additions? Seeing none, I guess we're ready for vote. All those in favor of putting it into the annual report, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay, we got. Let's do a couple of these out of order here. Goals update and the implementation might take a little bit longer. Frank had a few minor changes to December 5th, but he also, because he wasn't here tonight, wanted us to postpone it again. This is the minutes for December 5th. What kind of changes did he have, Toby?
He wanted to ask about the third bathroom.
Yeah,
he wanted to, I could read it, but he suggests to add in something along these lines. When the Parks and Rec chair offered a reason why the project would cost $400,000 more, he stated that there's a third bathroom. We added one for transgendered. I would like it pointed out that the bathrooms do not have to be labeled for either sex, and that two bathrooms would be enough. I also pointed out that at least three bids should be received for this project. It should be able to be accomplished for well under the $500,000 that has already been approved. Also, that the board was unanimous in consensus that Ken would vote no for the additional $400,000 request at the CPC.
And by the way, I checked back, we approved the CPC minutes, and yes, I did vote no. I mean, I was a little worried, but I mean, the discussion was, I was the only one that voted no, though.
Everyone else
voted yes. They spent a pretty good presentation on trying to convince us why they had to spend close to $160,000 to $200,000 to bring electricity and other utilities to this thing, which is it's just to me it's still a lot of money. I don't think it's going to be very successful at town meeting, but I could be wrong. I guess we probably ought to wait for Frank one more time. I know Kobe likes to get us the minutes as quickly as possible because it's a lot better to get them done while everyone can kind of remember what happened. But let's let that one slide one more time out of courtesy. Well, we're doing other things that kind of has to do with.
Do you want to pass out the budget?
Yes, that's a good idea. Elaine, I guess, gave us a copy of the budget. This includes basically everyone. She basically said, if you have any comments, talk to Elaine.
It does still include the planning board money for engineers.
Yeah, we have, I think that's under miscellaneous other contracted
that's
services.
Correct.
So we would still have 15,000.
1,500. 15,000. Oh, 15,000. Okay. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's all yours, though.
Yes, it is.
Oh, okay.
It is now.
Yeah, and that's why you talked to Elaine about the budget.
Yeah. And it seems somebody must be getting themselves a nice raise. It's probably Elaine.
No, I think she's transitioning my salary from.
Is that a headcount?
Sorry?
Is that essentially a headcount move? That salary change is 7,000?
The headcount's staying the same. She's transitioning. My salary right now is paid out of a 53E and a half account, so she's transitioning that into the budget. So that's a portion of my salary.
Okay. So, anyway, if anyone has any questions of this, pass it on to Elaine.
That's the whole land use department, so that involves planning, zoning, conservation, building, so it's everybody.
We don't spend any money on consulting services or visioning?
Well, the visioning group was, they did that visioning report that came up with all those slogans that are at the bottom of our master plan and a few other places.
Yes, we won't need that next year.
We're all out of vision.
We're all out of vision.
No. We'll do a vision in another 10 years or so.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good to know.
Yep. So, that's it on the budget. Let's see. Correspondence-wise, Elaine sent out to all of the town boards that are in the implementation plan for the master plan. She sent out a letter asking them to sign up, just like we're going to do as soon as we finish the public hearing, basically take responsibility. You know, Elaine filled that column out with who she thought was responsible for it, and they want to put a date on it and whether you need extra resources to do it. And
come with the implementation plan?
Yes. And so that's going there. And we'll try to reach out with those different groups. For a future agenda item, I'd like to get a presentation of the downtown corridor project as it sits now, so that we can start to put some questions before the town earlier.
Which agenda would you like that on?
We'll talk about where it is.
Okay.
The earlier that we can, because I'd like to get our comments in maybe before it goes to the public meeting, so that I think. You guys will have some good comments one way or the other. I mean, you're kind of used to looking at site plans and stuff like that. I think you'll envision that there's some good things and there's some bad things that are, on this. Let's see, we got 3 more minutes before the public hearing. Correspondence received an email today from Roy McDowell, and he stated that all the abandoned buildings up on Western Nurseries have been boarded up, which I think was a concern, and maybe we even wrote it in as a condition. So we have photos of that. So, you know, hopefully they'll come down. The ones that they're not going to need to use will come down sooner than not. But I guess while they're still there, he pays taxes on them, so
there's an advantage.
But they're not worth an awful lot at this point. Did anyone else have any future agenda items, per se? Liaison reports, CPC. We kind of finalized the number of items we're going to spend some money on this year. Other than the one we've talked about with Parks and Rec, most of them are kind of a lot more historical ones are more interesting than the other ones. They're doing a study to look at Reed Park and see what they need to get a realistic budget for what's there. So,
Ken, has there been an update on the dog park? What's the status on that? Who's in charge of it?
John can probably update the committee on that.
Yeah.
We're going to have a master plan, discussion of the master plan for the property at our next open space. But as far as I know, the dog park committee has not submitted where they want it, so we decided that it would be beneficial to actually master plan the site and present options for it to be located in that will have the least detrimental impact to the surrounding areas.
Also, what I've heard is there is a foundation, I guess it is, that does dog parks, and they give big grants, mm-hmm. and what we've got is enough that would instead of having a mediocre dog park, would have a fantastic dog park. And a couple other towns have gotten this grant. And I mean, there's really big money that's available. I mean, like hundreds of thousands
of
dollars.
That's like all they fund is dog parks.
And somebody rich at one point must have liked dogs and dog parks. Sure. And so...
Doggy roller coasters, Ferris wheels.
That's awesome.
I mean, they're really going... The problem is the queue for that, you couldn't build it like right away. It takes a while to get into their process. But if you get in there and get accepted, there's a lot of benefits. So I think Parks and Rec is part of that somehow.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So anyway.
And they have a subcommittee formed, I believe. So.
Okay. So anyway, I now see that we've only got a couple things left to talk about after this public hearing, but it's at 8:30. Come on down. We'll open the continued public hearing. This is an application for a minor site plan review, Hopkinton Pediatric Dental Associates, 79 Hayden Row. This is a proposal to construct about 1,100 square feet of additions to the existing dental office. Welcome back.
Thank you.
Seems like it's been a year.
Becoming regulars on this board.
Yeah. Seems like it's been a year since yeah. we've seen you guys.
It's a different year, that's for sure.
That's true.
Before we start, Brian, did you watch
I did watch the video.
Okay, so... Everyone that's sitting here is a voting member.
That's correct.
There's two, four, five, six. There's only we're missing two members. They need a majority vote for this. So, I would recommend you continue tonight and let's get this done.
Okay.
We left it at the last time. We actually got through all the detailed discussions of all the items. And we were kind of holding it until the ZBA could act. And you might notice, everyone in your pack, that we got a nice letter from the ZBA, or you guys mm-hmm. earned a nice letter from the ZBA, which gave them the variances that they needed to go for, which was really the last thing that was holding us up in our December meeting. The additional thing that came back that kind of is one of our yellow checkmark things that is a little bit different, the building design. The design review board ended up reviewing it, and they had a couple of minor changes. And let's just go backwards and just the couple things that they had suggested. They didn't want a metal roof on the addition, okay.
Which I was very surprised at. If you drive down Grove Street, there's at least a half a dozen houses that have metal roofs on porches. It's a common sort of traditional thing. I was really surprised at that. The color issue, I mean, it certainly could be, we were choosing a charcoal gray so it would blend with the rest of the roofing. But I mean, if we have to use shingles, we'll use shingles. But I was just surprised about that.
Did they give you a reason?
Did they give a reason?
Yeah. I'm sorry? Did they give you a reason?
They felt that it was commercial looking in a residential area.
Okay. It was funny. Is that a recommendation? Through the chair. Is
it
a recommendation?
It's funny because that issue came up at the ZBA, and the chairman said he just finished putting a metal roof on his porch.
Okay.
It's just a funny.
The ZBA thing. Did not require these
no.
changes?
No.
Okay.
As far as the setback from the corner, I can explain this. I don't know if you can all see this, but this is the point that we're talking about. Mm-hmm. And this dimension was arrived at not from this point back, but from this point forward. So the size of the building was established from this wall lining up with an interior wall. It's an important issue to have this dimension. Whether that's, you know, an absolute requirement, I don't know, you'll tell us, but I mean, I'd like to keep it flush. I don't see any real benefit.
What was their concern of making it flush? You couldn't line up the siding, or?
Yeah, it had to do with they didn't feel like, because of the new and the old, was it going to line up, and it may not look.
Well, what I generally do is I would continue the corner board down, and then you line up your clapboards. That's all you do. Mm. I don't see an issue there. But unfortunately, I wasn't there that night. Ken was there, and so I didn't have the opportunity to argue the points with him. But I mean, we'd like to keep it flush. It's I think it's a major thing.
Okay, and then the
who was the representative that was there?
Dr. Ken.
Dr. Webb, what was their issue?
I really think it was just an aesthetic one.
Yeah, they felt that once it was completed, it wasn't going to be as aesthetically pleasing because they weren't going to be able to match it completely. And if it's flush, it would be more obvious, where if it was staggered, it wouldn't be as obvious.
We can go forward.
We can go forward, yeah.
How far did they suggest moving?
I don't think you can. I think that's the one option that's not available.
Yeah, right.
How far did they suggest moving it back?
Not very, just slightly. Like,
a couple of inches.
I think with the corner board going down, I don't think it makes any difference.
I have a question.
Yeah,
it looks like clearly there was an original house, and then, you know, to the, I guess, the north side of the building, is that an addition as well that was placed a few years back?
Additions we did, yeah.
But they're 30 feet back.
Okay.
Yeah, not in the front.
And there's a lot of trees kind of over in that area, too. I'm not sure you see that addition too well from the street.
That is...
No, I was looking at... Well, yeah. According to this...
Yeah.
Yeah.
This rendering, it
this
looks like it's flush.
This is the original building.
Yeah.
And then you look down, and this is this is the new part here.
I see. Yeah.
But you know, I'm looking at the one. Wait a minute.
Okay.
What you're seeing, this here...
That setback.
Yeah. Is here.
All right.
So it's set back considerably.
Okay.
But if you actually went out to the site and looked at the rest of the building, everything blends very nicely. Mm-hmm. We wouldn't do anything that wouldn't.
And then the last issue they said is size of windows on the second floor, because I think they were worried about snow loading on the sills.
Well, the point was with metal roofing, oftentimes you'll use it with shallower roofs because it's more waterproof.
Mm-hmm.
It's a better job. But if we have to go to a shingled roof, what they were saying was to raise this roof and shorten the windows. all you would do is use a ice and water shield underneath the shingles over the entire roof, and that solves the problem too.
And I wouldn't change existing windows.
I'm sorry?
Those are existing windows that they're talking about shortening.
Yeah. I'm not gonna. I wouldn't ask them to spend the money to do that. That's, you know.
Right.
Well, ZBA didn't require any of these. Does anyone else feel that we need to insist upon this? I mean,
I don't think
so. You know,
so.
If the sills rot on those other windows,
that's our problem.
That's kind of your problem. Yeah. I mean,
but generally, I keep them, you know, probably 6 inches below. Mm-hmm. In the final analysis, it'll be about 6 inches below.
I've got some that are 6 to 8 inches on a sloping roof, and yeah, if there's a blizzard, there's a lot of snow that gets over the front of the windows. I mean, there's sometimes the blizzard will put it on the windows on the first floor.
Right.
I mean, it's. Unfortunately, hopefully we won't have that much snow tonight.
Right.
Okay, so I'm not seeing any requirement for us to make aesthetic changes to the building.
No, it's not being required of us by ZBA.
I don't see anything on the second and third one, but I'm just thinking a little bit about the metal roof, if there's any.
What's the pitch on that roof? Did you need a metal roof? Is that why you did it?
Or I'm sorry?
The metal roof. You mentioned earlier that a certain pitches should have a metal roof.
If it's under 3 and 12, generally this you've got to take extra precautions on that. But pitch a thing, you know, any grace, ice and water shield, and shingles over that, it kind of eliminates that problem. But from an aesthetic standpoint, I mean, you see this all over town. This is a common charcoal gray. You know, if you drive down Grove Street, you'll see at least a half a dozen of them. And it's a nice way to sort of accent that, because this pitch is different. This pitch is different than this pitch. So why not, you know, make a statement out of it? That's really what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. But I think it's 3 and 12. I'm not absolutely positive.
I'm fine with it.
Maybe they thought it was copper and it was going to be bright and shiny or something.
And turn to blue.
Yeah, blue-green.
Prevents ice dams. Usually prevents ice dams too, doesn't it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay, so I think we're now down to the point of public comment. Is anyone from the public here that wants to comment on this? Okay, seeing no public comment, let's discuss conditions and site plan standards. Site plan standards, as you see from Jennifer's memo, I believe everything complies, particularly now the ZBA decision takes care of condition H. Did you guys have a chance to look at the proposed conditions that Jennifer wrote in her memo? Let's give you a couple of seconds. So, did any board members have any comments regarding site plan standards or anything like that? Or any questions as to?
I have one question.
Sure.
On number D, where it talks about activities shall be screened from abutting properties, different methodologies. So my question is, has the group determined what type of screening that they would be using at this point?
Basically, I think it was the screening that they have existing. Basic has already screened the parking lot, and this is kind of major changes really to the interior of the project. So I believe we heard that all the trees and stuff stay. So the screening is already there.
Vegetation
there. Yeah, there was a row of arborvitaes on the south side of the parking lot, if I remember correctly, that we required either one, the last edition or the one before that. It's getting
probably the one before. Yeah, we didn't extend it.
Yeah,
right.
And we haven't heard problems from any of the neighbors in talking about.
Any problems with these?
They go on to the next page too. They go on to page 5, too.
Most of those are fairly standard. The only one that I was going to think about is the $5,000, given that this is fairly interior. I'm not sure we're going to get any silting out on the street from this, maybe. Maybe that should be reduced a couple thousand.
I always just leave it in, so it's whatever the board would like to.
Yeah.
Was the one from before that's still there? Do we know?
From 13? I don't know.
If you have one from before, did you ever get your bond or payment back from the time before? Before you pay it again, we'll check that.
Good idea.
We can check.
What?
COVID. I don't think we ever did.
I have a list, but
okay.
Of who paid, the statuses of anything. If you didn't ask for it back, then
I don't think
still
we did. I don't think we made a payment.
And if you didn't make a payment, you're not going to make it.
That's the best you can do, probably.
But then we're back to square one.
Well, let's go through the site conditions one by one then. The first one is if we get an awful amount of snow that you can't find a place to put it, you got to take it away. I doubt with that site you're going to get to there because you got back by the dumpsters, I believe. And if you didn't have to do it two winters ago, you probably don't have to do it. It won't happen. Mechanical equipment, I don't think you have any roof-mounted stuff, so that probably won't apply, but we put that in every condition. The dumpsters emptying, I'm sure we have that similar condition on the last time, because we typically do that, particularly the fact that you're in a residential area. Construction impacts, siltation, dust control, you got to worry about that. That's a standard one for us. Can't bury any debris on the site. Not that you'd have any place where you'd do that anywhere. Site lighting, including the light and the sign, should be off 1 hour and close business. Not sure whether we did that the last time, but it's gotten to be very standard with us recently.
No, because it's actually on it's a sensor. It's a motion sensor.
Do what?
Just like when we leave
motion
work
sensor.
At night,
yep.
It's dark.
Yep.
So it's just if you go to your car, it'll turn on, and then it turns off after we leave.
Sure. And then we have 7 is Director of Municipal Inspections. On this one, you're not doing anything to water or anything like that, so he probably won't call for that, but that's standard for us. Number 8, I think the $5,000's a little high for this small addition. I'd recommend we go to 3. You saying 3?
3.
3? Okay. We'll make one change to that. And then number 9, for the construction aspect, that's basically a town by law anyway, but we're now repeating that in almost everyone's site plan review because some people, the first time they get caught having an excavator running at 6:30 in the morning, they play that they didn't know it, and you put them on notice now. So that's it from the conditions. Is that acceptable? Okay. I think, let's see. Any public comment? No, I see none. Okay, I think we're ready to vote on approval at this point. The first vote would be a vote to determine that the project meets the requirements of a minor project under paragraph 210.134. So I'd entertain a motion to
so move. Second.
Okay. So further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. The next is a vote to determine that the plant complies with the site standards, and that's A through
R.
As kind of shown in the memo.
Pages 2 through 4.
2 through 4. So I entertain a motion to say that the plan complies with the site plan standards.
So moved.
Second. Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. And the last is to vote to approve the site plan with conditions 1 through 9 on pages 4 and 5 of her memo, except for it will be $3,000 for paragraph 8.
So moved.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. And so we got one more vote.
Yep.
Moved to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Moved and seconded.
I moved it.
You moved
Friend
it and seconded.
Friend.
Yeah. Okay.
Friend. I got you.
I moved it. Friend seconded.
I seconded.
Okay. So, motion before you is to close the public hearing. How do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, we will have
Thank
this
you.
Written up probably usually about a week or so, but congratulations. And
thank you.
Keep going on your business, and you know, look forward to seeing your next edition.
I don't think there's any more room on that site.
There's no appeal period, is there?
What?
There's no appeal period.
There is appeal period. Jennifer? Jennifer, what's the appeal period?
20 days.
Me too.
20 days. Why? Did you want to appeal it?
Oh, no.
It's
a chair.
Yeah. Okay.
How many dentists do you have over there? Huh? How many dentists? Just you or?
In the office?
Yeah.
No, there is 4 of us.
4 of you.
Yeah.
What?
It's but you can't have, there's no space, so you can only have 1 to 2
hanging. Oh, 2 hanging.
Yeah, at the most. There's just not enough room for us.
So just pretty soon you have to buy a bigger building, you know?
I'm tired. My eyes are tired.
I'm
my back
down.
Is tired.
I'm tired. You could always
let
somebody else get some partner.
Here we go. I can
get rid of some of the
problems. I did my share.
So you could be a landlord.
Yeah, that would be
nice. Okay. Thank you. Okay, the next item we want to take up is the implementation of items of the master plan. And basically, we're going to try to fill in the timeline and the primary responsibility aspects of this. The first one I see is on, well, it's page 77 of the master plan, but I'm just going with the
cheat sheet
version of it. First one is encourage site development that follows the natural features and contours of the land and whatever. That's an ongoing one, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of what we do while we're kind of doing that. So, and I would say we need no additional resources for that one.
No.
So that'd be a none.
So we're just going to go over ours, Ken?
Yes, we're only going over ours, unless while you're looking through that, if you see someone else that you think should be ours.
Okay.
But Elaine did.
I got a couple of those.
I got a couple too, I guess. Maybe some of these might also might be dual responsibility too.
I'm sorry, repeat that, Ken?
A couple might be dual responsibilities.
Well, I've thought about that, but is this primary responsibility? So
maybe you take the word
primary
off?
Okay.
I mean, because
you could always assume the first one listed as the primary. Because you have more than one.
You know, you could say the first one is might be Board of Selectmen too. But
well, I think you could argue that the Board of Selectmen would have some responsibility for all
sure.
of this.
Yes, okay. Let's just leave it the way it is. See what the open space people say. Okay.
We'll let you know next week.
Okay.
We'll talk to the chair.
The bottom of the page, land use 4, that's an ongoing, or let's call it yearly, because that's what Zach does for us.
Annually?
Annually. Yeah, annually is better than yearly.
To the point, Ken, do you want to put Zach on there as well?
Zach?
Well, Zach works for us.
Zach is an ad hoc committee.
Additional resource, Ken?
It's good. People working
for us. Maybe the additional resources could go Zach?
Yeah.
Or I'm thinking more resources beyond.
I don't know that they're. I mean, you already have that.
Yeah.
It's not really
a... We have to acquire.
Okay, so land use 5, evaluation of land use to ensure... Sounds like an annual, because it's written in that way.
Yeah, I mean, I'll be honest, a lot of yours are going to be annual and ongoing.
Okay. No additional resources. Okay. Limit to commercial creep. How would you, is that an annual?
I put that as ongoing.
Ongoing?
Because it's what you do.
Okay. No additional resources.
No.
And then we're down at the bottom of the page. To identify what town services will be required to serve.
So I have this as sort of a dual timeline. So the first sentence could be sort of, we could do that this year and change our applications and everything to require the applicants list what services they're going to need, so that could be a change for 2017. And then the rest, the semi-annual report would be an ongoing semi-annual thing. That's how I approached that.
Okay, so it's a change to regs is by the end of 2017.
Yeah.
So let's call it December.
Okay.
And then the other semi-annual report, we do that.
Ongoing, she said.
It would make sense to do that semi-annual report in December of every year for capital budget, or would they need it sooner?
So November? I would say, yeah, I think they work on that November. So why don't we say November? Like they start working on it in November, so if we get it to them for the November, they can have their budgets done by December.
Okay.
So I'll put that in November annually.
The discontinuing of paper streets. Let's give that about a 3-year time limit.
Well, I was confused about this one, because I thought Elaine had explained to me that this town meeting, this was going to end this project.
No, that's not the paper streets.
That's a different project, okay.
This paper streets is Osceola Street that we were just talking about.
No. That's a formal street that's built on.
In between.
Oh, that's
this would be like that one we did off of Leonard Street was a paper street.
Oh, yes.
Okay. Okay. So, yeah, so that you want that for a 3-year starting in 2018? Because we're not going to have anything from this May.
Right.
Let's call that 2020.
Right, the key is unconstructed, right?
And then for additional resources, I said we would need funding for engineering.
It's engineering and some legal.
And legal. Okay.
So is that town-owned property right now, or?
It Pence.
No, technically not really.
Okay. Yeah.
Paper streets are owned by developers if they're still around.
Okay.
There's a few that...
It's okay. We don't need to get sidetracked. I didn't mean to do that.
Well, that's why you need legal.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. The rest of that page, we're in good shape. We're looking at the top of page 80. New methods, developments to encourage protected and private land and limit the... Okay. I don't remember writing that one into the plan, but it's truly our thing.
But that is ongoing. I mean, I don't know that we want to... I think we should always be looking for new methods to encourage protected open space. And
yeah, ongoing.
Yeah. Sometimes with ongoing, you never close it out.
That's right.
But I also don't think you want to close something like that out because...
It's a principle more than...
Right.
Yeah. It's a goal. Action plan.
Okay.
A wildlife corridor. We don't have any of those?
No, we don't. Why don't we give ourselves 2 years?
I put 2019 for that one.
Oh, you guys think alike.
That's scary.
I mean, it's either something we can do or we can't do, and it's really just a survey of the town in areas where you might want to.
Like some of the lakes.
Don't we kind of have it vis-a-vis the gas pipelines and whatnot for town, the easements?
Yeah, there's a lot of that too, and then, you know, for a while the Coolidge property was thought to be a part of a wildlife corridor, and we kind of came with approval that, yeah, we're letting 30 of the acres not be developed or whatever, and that was enough. Whether there's more places that need somehow to get protected with it, are there like a zoning overlay that you have for a wildlife corridor that?
Never seen one, but that doesn't mean it doesn't exist. I'm sure we could.
Well,
I mean,
they talked about it a lot in that project, for sure.
Like, I'm not sure what zoning you would do.
I don't know either, but let's give it a couple of years, and if we can't figure out what we do it, then maybe we'll say it's not feasible.
Yeah.
Incentives for open space.
The next one I didn't know that was necessarily your goal. Or your implementation goal? I thought that would be more of a Board of Selectmen implementation goal because they really are the ones that provide incentives.
Why don't we take it to, we will present to them a recommendation.
So recommend incentives? Instead of provide?
Yes.
Yeah, we'll have to change the word.
Okay.
Recommend technical assistance.
I mean, you know, we can figure out if there's a way to do that. Let's give us a 2020 on that one. What?
2020.
Implement the open space and recreation plan. That's ongoing.
What number are you on?
And I didn't know if that was. Is it? Do you do that in this town?
We approve that plan.
Right. Because in other towns I've worked in, it's been the Conservation Commission that does that. So
we've written it.
Okay. So
to me, it's ongoing.
Okay.
I think that's an ongoing for the 12th one.
And that was my other. I thought that would be a Board of Selectmen too, because they're the ones that bring property to be purchased to town meeting, not the planning board.
Well, we took an annual goal to start looking at other units. You know, the selectmen got a lot on here as it is.
So that's ongoing?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, and the last one on that page, the Conservation Commission said that we protect the quality of surface water, groundwater, and wetlands. That's a duel between us and Conservation Commission in that we also do groundwater permits or stormwater.
Mm-hmm.
Or
yeah, stormwater permits.
Stormwater, you know, if we're out of the resource area, it's up to us to make sure that it's done correctly. So, and that's an ongoing, and there's no extra resources on that. Why don't we think about the resources? There's none required unless we talk about more.
Until the MS4 is in place.
You know. Oh, yeah.
Potentially harmful land use.
It's an ongoing, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
18. Ongoing.
Yep.
Well, now we've got a whole almost page of them here.
Which section is what? Housing and residential development.
H2. Jennifer, what did you think about that one?
I said either 2019 or 2020.
2020. We'll know what the census is going to look like about then.
That's true. And I did say for additional resources, we may want to hire a consultant to help us with that. But we may not, too, so it's up to you.
Occurred to the discussion. We kind of already did that at last town meeting. Let's also do this one at 2020.
H4?
H3.
You talking about the removing of the garden apartment bylaw?
Yep.
16.
Because
yep.
Actually be...
Wouldn't it be more like...
Well, H3 is just encourage discussion.
So you're saying H3 is ongoing?
I think it's ongoing, but...
Okay. And 2020 is 2020, basically.
H4 I had for 2020.
Sure. Okay. Oh, we also have an annual report with projections.
Mm-hmm.
So that's annual. So it's both.
And when did you annually want to do this report?
Let's do it at the end of the year.
At the end of the year.
Well, the end of the year, then we can throw it into our annual report that goes into town, you know, that, like the one, mm-hmm. It's another paragraph on.
All right, so December?
Yeah. Let's do it in January.
If you do have two different
timelines. For the previous year.
Yeah.
If you have two different timelines, you might want to break them up into two. Different goals.
We can timeline. We can kind of divide.
Specify that.
Yeah. H5 is ongoing.
Mm-hmm.
Where is that? The flexible community. Development?
That's the one where one in 10 units has to be affordable.
Oh. Okay.
And we're making a small change to it, but.
I put that for next year for 2018.
That sounds like a good idea. How about 2021?
For H7?
Yeah.
Sure, I had it for 2019, but we can't do it for 2021.
Yeah, well, 21, we won't know if we're below 10% until 21.
True.
87. What about 86? That's
2018. For H8, I put 2018 in there.
Yeah.
Okay.
That should be pretty easy.
And we're down at ED4.
I put that as 2018.
Though I have heard from people that our practice of attaching all of our stuff to the agenda makes us one of the most transparent boards in town. And the reporters really like it too, because they can just click on
it.
They can just click on it, and you know,
that could be a good thing or a bad thing.
That's right. They know if they need to come.
And then they get a quote out of Jennifer without even asking.
Without even talking to me.
Okay. Let's see. I'm on the page top of 84, 85. That's ongoing. Mm-hmm. It's a motherhood statement. From what I'm hearing on Elmwood Park,
I was just thinking about that.
The building at the end that's been vacant for 12 years or whatever has a brand new owner.
That's the EMC building?
The original EMC headquarters building at the end. They're working, they have some tenants that are going in, and they're about to subdivide it and break it up. That's what the word is. So the thought of rebuilding that whole bit, you know, probably the parking lot's going to stay the way it is back down that way. It's a nice building, and I think they got it for a couple of million dollars, so they can spend a couple of million dollars in the inside to bring it up to where it's a multi-tenant facility. And with that, you know, they can probably charge some reasonable rents and get some people in there.
A local company can, or is it somebody from...
It's one of the big real estate folks,
like,
right?
CBRE?
Yeah, do you remember who bought it, John?
Give me a second. If we go through it, I'll let you know.
Okay.
So I had that for 2020, 86.
If I think it's either going to happen in the next couple years or not going to happen at all. Now, Mr. Perry's stuff, there, you know, that's still in play, which is in the hotel district too. Well, this other building is too.
It's all right there, though, right?
It's all right there. So, but I don't see a grand scheme like was kind of thought about a couple years ago.
Wasn't Finn's vision inclusive of that EMC?
Oh yeah, yeah.
And doesn't that put a little bit of a
Yeah. Finn's property's big enough for a hotel. You know, he's in the district for that too.
So a good hotel.
A night, yeah.
Yeah. Just with this building now being purchased and, you know, talking about subdividing it and leasing it, I wonder what that does to that intersection too.
It's going to put a strain on it.
Yeah. We've gotten used to 12 to 15 years, whatever it is, of vacancy.
Yep.
Is that the one in the far back?
Yes. Way at, yeah.
So it's kind of weird.
It's on Elmwood Park. It's behind Perk and Elmer. The end of Parkwood Drive.
But it's kind of weird how Parkwood Drive goes around, right, and then it ends and becomes a parking lot, and then the road continues again. It's like...
No, it's not a full loop.
Yeah, because of the parking lot. It's kind of weird.
Yeah.
Parsons Commercial Group.
Parsons.
What did you think for ED7?
ED7, I thought would be not a planning board implementation, but a board of selectmen implementation, because.
But I
could be wrong. Because how do you diversify the tax base?
Let's see if we can stick that back onto the Board of Selectmen. We'll see where that's at. You're going to have to tell Elaine that.
Are there some... why is South Street mentioned, Ken?
Well, the redevelopment of South Street, a few years ago we took South Street and went to four floor zoning on one side and three zone on the other. Quite frankly, not one building has been, you know, knocked down. You know, we have a lot of flex buildings like the building that was right around where we just permitted the CrossFit folks. And, you know, that's also in the hotel district. And, you know, we were kind of hoping when we rezoned that, that it would encourage some guy to take that one-story flex office, low-value butler building type stuff, buy it, tear it down, and go up. Hasn't happened yet. I think, you know, there's going to be a couple of EMC buildings that are going to get sold shortly, I would think. And, but maybe, you know, maybe we're seeing an economic, you know, where we're going to make things in America again, and might be demand, you know, again.
I was just reading about that today.
I mean, it's...
Look at that, build me iPhones in the U.S.
Yeah, well, we, you know, it might...
Wilkinson? Could be. We got some buildings.
It,
servers.
You know, it you know, possibly could be. Okay.
Three-story CrossFit building. That's all the rage.
ED8, Jennifer?
Yes. Ongoing.
Okay. Okay. Then we're at CFS 3. I think what we ought to do is maybe retain a consultant, because quite frankly, I've did this in the 90s, and there's very limited spots that we haven't already identified for this. This can be basically closed out fairly easy with a consultant.
Okay.
And maybe in the next couple of years.
Do you want to put an end date on it?
Yeah, let's go
2019.
But we'll need, I can easily update, because I have it all in my head as to what spots to look for that are left.
And on that one, would you also want to potentially have as additional resource DPW?
They'll be definitely involved in the whole bit. We use the same consultant that they would use. Okay. I mean, it's...
So it's kind of just a sum?
Yeah. One of the things that's similar to that, right now with our Water Management Act stuff, with my state job, I'm bringing together town officials and DEP people to talk about this impasse we have on trying to get our permits.
Got it.
So, let's see, we're...
Page 88.
88, huh? We're doing good.
Yes.
New trails. Ongoing. Okay. Ongoing. That's, yep. That's an easy one. Are we getting close to being done?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
One more.
Ah, one more.
Put that for 2019. But I don't know if we need more time.
What did we say for the other paper streets?
Oh, I think we said 2020.
2020, so let's make it the same.
Okay.
What about the action plan item on page 89 at the top?
That's the board's locking it.
Yeah.
It's continuation from 88.
Okay. You made progress?
I like progress.
Okay. Last item for tonight is goals. John, did you have some more that you were working on for yours?
Yes, I wanted to get input with the expansion of the maintenance of the sidewalks snow, etc. There were two different models out there, one saying the front of your property, you do it, and then some of the communities have a stratified based on designation. And I have contacted the various communities, two each, to get feedback on how is it working. You know, is it, are you having problem? I try to identify similar communities to ours where people in the heavy residential area are going to say, nobody walks on it, what are you making me, you know, do it for? So I'm waiting for the feedback on that that I should have for the next meeting.
Okay. Anyone else make any progress on their goals?
John's our main man. We need somebody to step in.
We already made progress tonight on our goal on the master plan, which is a collective one, so we'll pat ourselves on the back and entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved. Second.
All those in favor of adjourning, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Meeting's adjourned.
Did you guys see, did anybody?